When you look across the history of critical care, you will find thousands of contributions that have helped save lives and improve outcomes for patients in need. One thing all those contributions have in common is that they came from dedicated individuals who had the passion to make changes happen. Let's take a look at some of those critical contributions. Critical care began when Florence Nightingale established monitoring units to triage the most seriously injured soldiers. She placed the sickest patients closest to the nursing station, allowing for increased observation, which resulted in dramatically reduced mortality rates. These positive outcomes would spark others to develop more specialty care units, though they would not become standard until nearly a century later. In 1923, Walter Dandy established the first intensive care unit. It was 3 beds in Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland, and is considered to be the forerunner of present-day ICUs. In the Copenhagen polio epidemic, hundreds of patients had respiratory failure. In 1953, Bjørn Ibsen, the anesthetist who suggested positive pressure for polio, set up the first ICU in Europe to help treat them. Peter Saffer at Baltimore City Hospital then established an ICU with 24-hour physician coverage. In 1967, the first multi-professional pediatric ICU in North America was opened at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. 2 years later, another pediatric ICU opened, this one in Pittsburgh, with help from Peter Saffer. As these ICUs became more common throughout the United States and Europe, three thought leaders, Max Harry Weil, Peter Saffer, and William Shoemaker, attended a 1968 meeting in Atlantic City. During a stroll down the boardwalk, they discussed a revolutionary concept that clinicians from different specialties and professions could create an alliance and work together in a patient-focused environment. They were planting the seeds for the future of critical care and for a multi-professional society to foster its advancement for decades to come. These pioneers gathered a group of about 36 like-minded professionals in 1970 in Los Angeles to combine thoughts, plans, and experiences. Together, they would form a new field called critical care medicine. Their ideas were revolutionary and controversial. By 1971, this group of visionaries had grown to 54 members. They formally adopted a constitution, and the Society of Critical Care Medicine was officially established. Its mission? To secure the highest quality care for all critically ill and injured patients. Among the first accomplishments was an independent annual meeting held in Southern California in February 1972. Max Harry Weil, in the first presidential address, summarizes the Society's first goals: to develop educational programs and standards of practice. The same year, guidelines to organize critical care units were published in the Journal of the American Medical Association. This seminal document defined critical care units, and outlined the staff and skills needed to run them. The next president, Peter Saffer, was regarded as the activist of the group. He launched the Critical Care Medicine Journal, with William Shoemaker as editor. Peter Saffer called the choice to create a new journal the most difficult decision of his presidency, in part because of the financial risk inherent to the organization's small membership. Today, Critical Care Medicine is the specialty's leading journal. In 1978, Norma J. Shoemaker became SCCM's first executive director, and the first SCCM office was established in Anaheim, California. Norma Shoemaker was a remarkable leader who implemented key aspects of business management, establishing SCCM as a professional organization. In 1980, the American Board of Medical Specialties approved critical care medicine as a subspecialty of internal medicine, anesthesiology, pediatrics, and surgery. SCCM's first specialty section, pediatrics, was established in 1982. 2 years later, Dharmapuri Vidyasagar, a leader of the pediatric section, became SCCM's first president from the pediatric specialty. SCCM also held its first high-profile event in Washington, D.C. in 1984, the MASH Bash. Guests to this charitable event included two television actors who played doctors, as well as Senator Edward Kennedy. At the end of the decade, SCCM established the American College of Critical Care Medicine to recognize superior achievement and commitment. Today, the Fellow of Critical Care Medicine and the Master of Critical Care Medicine designations are widely respected in the field. To better plan for the future, in 1990, SCCM developed a strategic plan and other resources, like the ICU Census Project, which collected data about ICUs and critical care. The same year, SCCM established a task force on disaster and critical care. It soon was called upon for its first mission, helping the U.S. Army find critical care teams to support Operation Desert Storm. Nearly 2,000 members joined the volunteer pool. This was the first of many disaster response efforts led by SCCM. In 1991, the first sepsis definition was developed during a consensus conference co-hosted by SCCM. This set the foundation for SCCM to lead in sepsis research for decades to come. The ICU census data collected at the start of the decade were published in the Flag Book in 1992, which was distributed to legislatures and healthcare advocates to raise awareness about critical care. That same year, the first five SCCM chapters were approved in New England, New Jersey, Michigan, the Southeast, and in the Carolinas-Virginia region. The first fundamental critical care support course was held in 1994 to offer basic critical care education to non-intensivists. FCCS would go on to be one of SCCM's most far-reaching programs. As the new millennium approached, SCCM boasted nearly 10,000 members, and critical care medicine was recognized as one of the 100 most influential biomedical science journals. And the organization departed its California roots to pursue its goals in Chicagoland. The year 2000 brought many changes to critical care. Telemedicine investigators at Johns Hopkins proclaimed that remote ICU care could be performed effectively with substantial benefits for patient outcomes. The first issue of the Pediatric Critical Care Medicine Journal was published with Patrick Kohanek as the editor. The year also saw the first physician woman president of SCCM, Carolyn Beckes. After the September 11th attacks, SCCM further refined its disaster response, developing a volunteer database and communications plan. SCCM was now ready to meet the volunteer requirements of any event. It would launch the Fundamental Disaster Management Program 2 years later, ensuring healthcare professionals were prepared. In 2002, the annual Scientific and Educational Symposium was renamed the Critical Care Congress. 2002 was also the year Maureen Harvey became the first nurse president of SCCM. New research and best practices in sepsis emerged, and in 2004, as part of the newly established Surviving Sepsis campaign, SCCM published guidelines in critical care medicine. In 2005, SCCM's emergency response efforts were utilized in collaboration with the National Institutions of Health to send volunteers to help victims of Hurricane Katrina. SCCM's multi-professional critical care review course debuted internationally in Beijing in 2006. As the first decade of the 21st century came to a close, SCCM was poised to bring its vision for critical care to a global audience. In 2010, Judith Jacoby became the first pharmacist president. SCCM also mounted a response to the Haiti earthquake, sending volunteer members to hold several fundamentals courses. By 2012, the organization's global growth began to boom. SCCM was represented by members from more than 100 countries, had held courses in 43 countries, and opened an office in China. With the release of the Pain, Agitation, and Delirium, PAD, guidelines in 2013, the ICU Liberation Initiative was launched. Most patients survived an ICU stay, so ICU Liberation ushered in new thinking about delirium, pain management, and other aspects of care for a renewed focus on improving long-term outcomes. In 2015, the SCCM Weill Research Trust was established to fund research grants in perpetuity and expand opportunities. 2 years later, the SCCM Discovery Research Network solidified SCCM's leading role in research. By 2020, the fundamentals programs had expanded to meet more specialized needs and had trained more than 250,000 healthcare professionals in 33 countries. 2020 was also the year the Surviving Sepsis campaign published the first sepsis guidelines for children. They were the highlight of the 49th Critical Care Congress. As the SCCM prepared to celebrate its 50th anniversary the next year, in a fitting tribute, the word intensivist was added to the dictionary. Then the world and critical care changed forever as the COVID-19 pandemic spread across the globe. ICU clinicians found themselves on the front lines, risking their lives to battle a deadly infectious disease. Clinicians raced to uncover and understand the best treatment strategies, to creatively source personal protective equipment, to quickly expand staffing and facilities, and to compassionately comfort patients unable to have loved ones at the bedside. These ICU clinicians were heroes, each and all, for their commitment, bravery, and sacrifices, isolating from loved ones, working around the clock, and showing up day after day to face the unknown. Some tragically lost their lives in service. We now face a future, though altered by a disruptive and tragic event, that is filled with more possibility than ever before. Our connections to colleagues are closer. We are now bound together forever in shared experience. We cannot predict the future, but we know critical care will never be the way it used to be. It will be better and stronger. SCCM's Discovery Virus COVID-19 Registry, the largest database of ICU patients with COVID-19, will pave the way for infectious disease research for decades to come. And we see more advances on the horizon. Telecritical care, increasingly relied upon in emergencies, will also continue to bridge gaps for rural and underserved areas. As our understanding of post-intensive care syndrome evolves, early mobilization and other interventions from the ICU Liberation Initiative will become a standard of care. Novel trial designs will lead to faster and more confident results. That means life-saving interventions will reach the bedside far sooner. When we meet to celebrate SCCM's 60th anniversary, our Congress may explore topics that once seemed like science fiction. We may be able to regenerate and reanimate failing organs. Our treatments may rely upon instantaneous immunotherapy assessments. Artificial intelligence will predict decompensation before it even starts, and it may provide individualized treatment decisions for serious illness, such as sepsis. It took a little more than 100 years to build the first ICUs, from Florence Nightingale to Max Harry Weill and Peter Saffer. It took a little over 50 years from the first ICUs to the current state of critical care. It will take less than 30 years to realize a future that today may seem unimaginable. Together, we will go bravely into the new era of critical care, and SCCM's mission will remain forever unchanged: to secure the highest quality care for all critically ill and injured patients.